So I mentioned the Brooklyn Society, and that was where I met our speaker, Kurt Johnson. He is also, besides being very involved with the ethical movement, he's a member of the National Service Conference. Some of you may know that over the years that's changed. It was originally the Women's Service Conference, then the National Service Conference, now it's the National Ethical Service. This is an NGO at the United Nations, and Kurt is very involved there. He's also an author, and his upcoming book is called The Coming Interspiritual Age, which has been getting quite a bit of advanced media buzz, about which we're all very excited. He's been an ethical culture member for over 30 years. Again, vice president of Ethical Culture's NGO, the National Ethical Service. He's also on the faculty of the Humanist Institute, which I'm happy to serve as co-dean, and we take advantage of his services often as a faculty. He's also a scientist at the New York City's Natural History Museum for over 25 years, and he teaches at New York's One Spirit Interfaith Seminary, and works with or co-founded a number of organizations and networks across what's called the evolutionary consciousness, interspiritual and integral movements, which may be new to some of you. So I'm really appreciating that he's going to talk with us about that and also making a connection to our own founder, Felix Adler. So here's Kurt.
Thank you. I got to get my paraphernalia ready here. All right. It's always good to be in ethical culture because this is one of my root communities and I always feel at home here. So I really appreciate the opportunity. In thinking about, what to say today when there's so much that could be said, and you'll see that I'm pulling my watch out here so I can discipline myself. I think all of you are familiar with Eckhart Tolle and his two most famous books, The Power of Now and A New Earth. The Power of Now has sold 60 million copies, and A New Earth has sold about 20 million copies. And I think you know how popular A New Earth became after Eckhart was on Oprah, and they had 3 million people that tuned into that program. Well, what happened is that Namaste Publishing, which is Eckhart's publisher, really started to see that the vision that Eckhart was talking about in the New Earth was grounded in what's unfolding worldwide with multiple movements, efforts, inspirations, and visions toward what some concept of a global unity, global homogeneity might look like if our species is fortunate enough to have a good future and not a difficult future. So they actually came to me about a year ago, mostly because my background, as Anne says, across so many different disciplines, and really asked the question, can we show that if we really look at the hard data behind what's unfolding in the world, is the inspirational message that Eckhart Tolle was talking about in The New Earth, is that all just dreamland and inspiration, or can we actually lay out the undeniable trends that yes, at least a great sector of the world, and I'll talk about some that aren't, but at least a great sector of the world is wanting to move in that positive direction. That the future could be a soft landing for what our planet could look like and not a hard landing. Now, that kind of explains the buzz around this book because we've done, I think, what is a, we've done a very good job at bringing the entire narrative in a way that really has touched people. And we have had 50 spiritual and transformation leaders from across all the traditions, without any exceptions, really step up to endorse this book. And even last week, because this book came out on the 14th, so I've actually even been on NPR twice in the last week, once with David Corton, who you may know is the Harvard economist who has a bestseller out now called Agenda for a New Economy. In other words, how structural change could happen at the economic level. And then I just did a program 2 days ago on NPR with Ken Wilber. You may know he's the most published philosopher in the world. And he's the one who's looking at what's called an integral view, again, of how everything is trending this direction. Now, what I wanted to share about today, which should make us all feel maybe a little bit smug about ethical culture and humanism, is that by a really kind of peculiar sleight of hand, the core message that is in all of these movements is actually the same message that Felix Adler wrote about in Life and Destiny and Reconstruction of the Spiritual Idea. And it's absolutely profound that the integral movement, which is really a philosophical vision of how the world could move toward a homogeneous world culture, the evolutionary consciousness movement, which is really a group that understands psychology and sociology and everything in light of the developmental understanding of change that arose with the Darwinian model, that we don't live in a static world. I mean, as you know, religions have always basically taught static worldviews. In 1865, when Origin of Species was published, then it was a game changer, because once you have a developmental world, it's a different world. So the evolutionary consciousness movement, and if you Google any of these, you'll see, you know, 50 to 100 major authors who are all in these different movements, who are pushing these agendas. So the understanding of the developmental view of history and where we're trying to go, that's what the evolutionary consciousness movement is. Also, the interspiritual movement, probably the most well-known person in that, or the two you may know the most, are the Dalai Lama and Archbishop Desmond Tutu. And then there are some really famous contemplative leaders like Father Thomas Keating, Brother Wayne Teasdale, who was my mentor, because I come out of a monastic background in the Anglican Church before I was a humanist. And that movement is actually addressing how do we get the religions to switch from their emphasis on religion, which I'll define here in a minute, from how the Dalai Lama looks at that, and how do we get them to change to the very thing that ethical culture and all of humanism has always talked about. That in a world that's globalizing, let's face it, it ain't gonna work for all the religions to be arguing about whose absolute truth is true, whose end time scenario is true, whose Messiah is coming at the end. This is gonna go nowhere except to be a tremendous liability for the future of the species. So the question the interspiritual movement is asking is, how do the religions become an asset toward our future? And so the message that's actually in the interspiritual movement is, how do we go back to fundamental? It's amazing, because you'll see when I read the Dalai Lama's definition of spirituality, it's just vintage Adler. How do we go back to how kind we are with each other, what we build together in a world of love and in forgiveness and tolerance and embracing each other and forgetting these claims that would divide us? And actually, the interspiritual movement, which has representatives from all the traditions, and interestingly enough, basically all their major mystics, because the deeper that people go in their plumbing of the interior space, the message is not a religious message, it's a message about relationship and about connection and about what relationship and connection imply for the type of world that we want. So the religions are in a very interesting situation now. I think if you look at, for instance, example, the Roman Catholic Church, they're talking now about a Roman Catholic Spring. And if you look at the dynamics of the Roman Catholic Spring, it's all being led by the nuns. But I think, as you know, the Pope came out about a month ago and came down on the nuns for being too involved with social justice and economic justice and not on their agenda against homosexuals and against abortion and so on. So you really see this tension between, as Adler would say, what the inner urges are saying about how we have to be in a world that could work, and people who are still living in a world in boxes. The other big movement that's out there is called the Sacred Activism Movement, and these are people who are agreeing with what all these other movements have said, but they're saying, let's put our feet on the street. Let's just not just write books and inspire people. Let's get out there and let's build new structures and new communities that actually reflect and manifest the vision that we're talking about. And Andrew Harvey, you may know his name, his most recent book is The Hope. He's also a classic figure in the divine feminine world, because his book, Return of the Mother, is one of the classics in the whole understanding of the emerging pivotal role of the feminine voice in where things are going. So what's interesting then is that I make very clear in the coming of the spiritual age of Adler's role in articulating the underpinnings of this vision. And I say it in quite a number of places, and I mention it because I actually got some blowback from reviewers and other people saying I gave humanism too much credit. You know, the humanism kind of sputtered, you know, yeah, it became the default setting for the secular world, but it didn't go anywhere in a big way. Well, that's typical of any view that's ahead of its time, right? So we could put Adler in there, as we do, with Sri Aurobindo, who was India's great thinker, labeled by the British as the second most dangerous person in India other than Gandhi, and who had to flee to the French colonies in India so that he didn't get either put in jail or executed for treason. But he was also a person in the 1950s who wrote from this same vision. In fact, he was so convinced that this vision, which was the same one Adler was talking about, that he actually dedicated himself to writing books instead of running his community. He had his companion run the community because he said 20 or 30 years from now, the world's going to discover that the Western vision of this vision is not enough and they're going to need an Eastern vision. And he was absolutely right. So when the developmentalists arose in the academic community, late 1800s, early 1900s, which again was Adler's era, everybody discovered Aurobindo, and Aurobindo now is a huge name in this discussion. The other one that you know is Teilhard Chardin, the great Catholic scientist priest, who also had this cosmic cosmology of everything being about moving toward our maturity as a species. 14 billion years of history from the Big Bang, working toward what we look like as a mature species on this planet, which was exactly what Felix Adler was talking about. So, good news for humanism, right? Right, it's great. We can feel kind of smug. And I basically told people, let's give Adler credit where credit is due, because he was just dead on the money with so many of his insights. So the question then comes up, well, how did this happen? In other words, it may be news to you as an ethical culture person or as a humanist for many decades that, wow, suddenly all these other movements have appropriated Adler's vision and it's out there in a huge way, you know? So how did it happen? Well, one of the main ways that happened, to be honest, is shifts in the understanding of the difference between spirituality and religion. And it's interesting that Robert Tapp, who's the former chairman, dean, what do you call it?
Former dean.
Former dean of the Humanist Institute, when he wrote a blurb to this book, he basically said, humanists, this is one of his lines, humanists will appreciate this book because of its wide coverage of the many writers who have worked to distinguish spirituality from religions, all right? So what did he mean by that? Now, there's a very interesting shift in these definitions over the last couple of years, and last couple of decades. So I'm gonna read you what the Dalai Lama says is his definition of religion. Religion, he says, I take to be concerned with faith in the claims to salvation of one tradition or another, an aspect of which is acceptance of some form of metaphysical or supernatural reality, including perhaps an idea of heaven or nirvana. And connected with this are all kinds of religious teachings that involve dogma, creed, ritual, prayer, and so on. Well, that sounds like religion to me, right? And that sounds like the way that ethical culture would have traditionally defined religion. But here's what's interesting. How then does the Dalai Lama now define spirituality? And here's what's interesting. Both of these definitions are in his book, Ethics for the New Millennium, right? No surprise. Ethics for the New Millennium. Because actually, when he wrote this book, he said, the ethical path is the only road that all the traditions have to walk down together. They ain't gonna walk down a common road, you know, about who's God, who's sacred text, who's Messiah, who's end times narrative. Ain't gonna happen. You know, anthropologically, if we're just honest, even as a scientist, all those claims, either they all can't be true or they're all true, because the spirit world may be channeling everything imaginable to folk down here. But the result's the same. If people don't agree, we're gonna have we're going to have calamity. So what can they agree on? Well, here's the Dalai Lama's definition of spirituality. Spirituality, he says, I take, to be concerned with those qualities of the human spirit, which are love, compassion, patience, tolerance, forgiveness, contentment, a sense of responsibility, a sense of harmony, all that brings happiness to both the self and to others. Now, that sounds like ethical culture, right? That sounds like Adam. So what's happened then in the last couple decades, as this conversation has clarified across all these movements, you've gotten a change from religion defined as we just defined it. But the old idea of spirituality was, well, it's the really phantasmagoric, woo-woo stories that religion dreams up relative to mystical experience and everything that goes on with that type of stuff, and prayer and all that, that's spirituality. But that's what's changed. And a lot of that's because of science and because what's gone on in physics. What's happened now is the understanding of spirituality as the Dalai Lama defines it, in the same way Adler did, as all of these qualities of who we are at our deeper level, as we've kind of been because of this shift to understanding that as consciousness. So now you have spirituality is consciousness, whereas a couple decades ago you had spirituality is lots of weird and phantasmagoric stories about religion, right? Now you really see this emerge at a big level. Let's say about a year ago there was this discussion on Charlie Rose, which I think all of you watch, and the discussion was with James Watson, who's one of the discoverers of DNA, Watson and Crick, and E.O. Wilson, the famous Harvard biologist who's the father of sociobiology. And so Charlie Rose asked them, he said, if DNA was the paradigm shifter for this generation, what's the paradigm shifter for the next generation? And here's what's cool. They both said, understanding consciousness. That the next step for us is going to be understanding consciousness. Now that's where they agree, but here's where they disagree. And I mention it because what it does is that it characterizes where this discussion is kind of at, right? Now Watson's an atheist, so right away he said, yes, it's about consciousness, but the entire history of religion, parents, the great wisdom traditions, or the combined reservoir of human wisdom, has nothing to add to that conversation, right? Which is exactly, well, I won't go into certain philosophies which show where that's coming from among alternatives. But Wilson was not on that bandwagon, because I think you know Wilson has written a tremendous book called Consilience, one of his bestsellers. And Consilience means exactly consilience. And what Wilson is about, again, how do we pull together all the skill sets of the species, the interior skill sets and the exterior skill sets, and by that I mean the subjective spiritual consciousness skill sets and the scientific, technological, intellectual skill sets, and how do we have those in kind of a skillful yin and yang, where those are working together from the totality of who we are to build the world we're talking about. So it's interesting that Wilson went that way. Now, in the reactive world, Wilson got blacklisted then by atheist.com for selling out to religion. But again, that's an incredibly narrow attack on Wilson. He's actually a far more holistic thinker than Watson. So what results then is that we're moving into an epoch of change. Obviously, we're moving into an epoch of who the hell knows what's going to happen. I mean, we're looking at fiscal cliff, we're looking at global climate change, and we're really in a situation of not knowing which way this thing is going to go. I mean, I was just down in a meeting at DC in Washington about people who were in this discussion, and you know, not to rain on the parade, but there are so many people who think it's already too late, that it's already too late on climate change, and that it's already too late on the world financial system, and the only way is some type of a big collapse before there's some type of structural change, because the people in power simply don't get it. They're about immediate winning the next election or immediate profits and any vision of the future. Now, the result of that conference was saying, you know, we really can't go there. Where the world is at is kind of like somebody who was just told they had cancer. And when you're told you have cancer, if you're conscientious at all, you don't just bag it. You actually say, look, I'm going to opt for the possibility that I can beat this thing. And what I really admire about all the movers and shakers that are in this conversation is most of them have made that decision. We don't know which way it's going to go, but we have to act as if there's a chance that things can go another way. I mean, you may know Paul Hawkins' work, Blessed Unrest, was his bestseller in 2007, was a big blockbuster about all the grassroots movements for change. And he has a famous line about that where he says, if you still have hope for humanity, you haven't seen the data. But if you don't have hope for humanity, you don't have a heart. And so we're in that kind of a tug of war. So in that then, we've got these major movements all trying to address different aspects of what transformative change would look like. And the great historic sleight of hand is that the way forward is exactly the one that Adler elucidated in Life and Destiny and Reconstruction of the Spiritual Idea. Deed over creed. Everybody thinks it's a new idea. It's Adler's idea over 100 years ago. The idea that the religions need to move toward their common ethical foundations as their path and just get over their differences about dogma. That's the message now that was Adler's message 100 years ago. So just to move ahead here, because I've got a little bit more time. Cosmos Journal then, which is one of the big magazines, one of the big glosses that monitors all this, they did an article about 2 weeks ago on the major points that we make in this book, The Coming Inner Spiritual Age. And I just want to mention a few of those and then make a comment on what's driving that. And then at that point, I think we might be close to about my 20 minutes. The major points that Cosmos pulled out of our book was really asking, are there trends that we've demonstrated in this book that are undeniable? In other words, that when you lay out the data, are there trends that are undeniable? And here's the ones that they say. The first is, and some of these are no-brainers, but they're important to point out. First is that globalization is inevitable. Globalization is inevitable. The question is, what is that going to look like, and who is going to make the decisions of what that will look like, right? The second one, which is part of that, is that multiculturalism is also inevitable. But the question is, what is that going to look like? And the big question is, with globalization and multiculturalism is, are the decisions going to be made by the financial institutions, the politicians, the power brokers, the financial elite, or is this huge reservoir of human wisdom that we actually have across all the traditions, one of which is humanism, is there going to be an activist role in the voice of where multiculturalism and globalism go from those deeper voices, from, let's actually say, a deeper part of our nature, call it our ethical nature, call it our spiritual nature, call it whatever you will, but is that going to get into the arena, okay? The other thing that they pull out of our book is that there's absolutely no doubt that unifying points and understandings of unity and what unity would look like are emerging in every arena of discourse on the planet. Doesn't matter if you're looking at science, spirituality, governance, economics, all you gotta do is Google and you're gonna find thousands and thousands of ideas of what a globalized society might look like that is structured in a way that is very skillful about where that may go. The other point they pull out is that science is constantly bringing to the fore, remember Higgs boson about 4 months ago, is constantly bringing to the fore new information about how reality is a unified whole, and how they use the term holonic, that everything is a part and everything is a whole. Everything is interconnected, just like the ecosystem is. And that we're coming now to a profound understanding that reality itself is structured in this amazingly unified way. The other point that they pull out is that new self-evident truths are arising, right? Now this is really, really interesting because you'll remember that why we're here in the United States is because in the 1700s and 1800s, the ideas of the Renaissance about the value of the human individual managed to uptip 70 centuries of monarchy. That's amazing. We don't think of it. There had been 70 centuries of monarchy worldwide before the ideas in the Renaissance, took about 250 years, finally tipped the structures of the world toward participatory governance, right? So we've been in this era, this rational era, then about the value of the individual. But the self-evident truth that's arising now, and it's underneath the Arab Spring, it's underneath Occupy, it's underneath the Catholic Spring, is if we are a part of a collective, and obviously anybody who's got a brain knows we're a part of a collective, there are certain types of mutual responsibilities within a collective about how the members of that collective serve each other that just have to be taken into account. And these are not the models Wall Street is using today. They're not the models that the banks are using today. They're not the models that the dictatorships in the Middle East are using today. So there's this eruption worldwide of the self-evident truth that a collective has responsibility to itself, and that a part of that responsibility has to do with access to resources. That in this human community, there has to be an equitable access to resources. And the hope is, and I think it's a no-brainer, that that understanding is going to become so embedded on the man on the street, just like the idea of the individual became so embedded that 70 centuries of monarchy got upturned, that that's where so many people see hope to where this is all going. Because you're not going to do this by teaching people, you're not going to do this by convincing people, but if the gestalt, the worldview of people is changing, so what they assume is true changes, then things change. Great example, how did the Iron Curtain come down, the Berlin Wall come down? Everybody on the east side of the Iron Curtain finally decided, we don't want to live this life. And once they all decided that all at once, that was enough gravitas to bring those systems down. All right, the last one is, and there's a lot more here, but I'm just running out of time. But the last one is that obviously, worldwide, very strong negative forces and very strong positive forces are vying with each other. It's almost like a good guys and bad guys scenario, and we of course have to avoid that becoming a divisive thing. But that's obvious. And when we look at that, in the sense of people who really have a holistic view of where this may go, and people who are still opting for their own selfish view of where this may go, the truth is it could go either way. I think everybody right now who looks out at the planetary situation says, you know, it could go either way. All right, just one final point. That is this question of what's driving this. There's some amazing brain-mind research now. Starts with a guy at Princeton named Julian James, who wrote a classic book in the 70s about it, and other people have worked on that. It's just really important to understand. I want to summarize that briefly. Is that, you know, we're animals, of course, right? So how do we answer the question about why we are so unbelievably different than any other animal on this planet? There ain't nothing that's close to us, right? Well, it has to do with how our brain mind evolved into more and more complex consciousness. And if you can imagine in your mind going back to cavemen and early folk, and then imagine yourself on up through the Egyptian and Sumerian period, there was a gradual development in consciousness of our brain being able to have a discussion with itself. That's actually the definition of consciousness, is when one part of the brain can be aware of what another part of the brain is doing and can have a discussion with itself and make decisions. Your dog doesn't do that, cat doesn't do that. You know, there are some animals that have a little bit of that. Elephants, dolphins, go through the list. But nothing like us, right? You know, we have been on this amazing trajectory of matching awarenesses with new skill sets. And all of our precursors, Neanderthal man, all the others, the other 11, who didn't make it, that's why they didn't make it. We're not able to match an awareness with a skill set. And that actually is what defines the world situation right now. You can look at the last election. Are the awarenesses true or are they bullshit? Are they false? Because if we make decisions based on stories that aren't true, they can't be adaptive decisions. They're not going to lead us to a positive future, right? So just one final point then. So what Julian James and these other workers say is that when the Renaissance came along, what arose in the human consciousness was this new level of dialogue, which instead of looking toward the Pope, toward the King, toward, started to understand the innate value of every individual and that being part of the conversation. From that arose the rational era, the Industrial Revolution, and actually the view of the cosmology as the grand machine, what became then science, right? But the way that the brain-mind scientists talk about what's happening now is they're saying that the gestalt that has caused the Arab Spring, Occupy, Catholic Spring, is because the mind, and look at the statistics on how younger people look at things across boundaries with regard to sexual preference, race, the old boundaries don't mean anything to this generation that's coming up. And the reason, the scientists say, is that the brain mind is continuing to evolve to see that everything is interconnected. And as we move toward that gestalt of interconnectivity, it's going to predict a different world, just like the rising of the individual in the Renaissance predicted another world. So this is an exciting time. I mean, I remain optimistic, and I remain optimistic, not because I'm really faithful that we can get this stuff taught, but I would lay my money on the brain-mind scenario, that if after 70 centuries of monarchy, we were actually able to upend that and create participatory governance because the mental framework had changed, I will sign on to the Janes and other scientists who are saying where we seem to be going now is this gestalt of unity. And what we say will happen is probably decades of experimentation with what that means. And that will mean people experimenting with different models. A good example is in Bhutan in Asia. Is a country now that has set out national goals, and all of its policies are measured against will it or will it not fulfill that national goal, which is defined for the well-being of everybody in that country. Health, education, well-being, leisure, go through the list. Instead of this crazy runaway train that we're on here in the West where we don't know where it's going, and anybody with power can kind of run it anywhere they want to go. So that's kind of it. But what is amazing, as a humanist, I think you'd say, wow, thank God. Everybody who's here is here because you see something in humanism that, you know, rang a chime. And you say, you know, this makes sense to me, right? And I think, you know, obviously it's just interesting that Adler's vision has then ended up making sense to, you know, all these other folk who are part of this now. I'm 5 minutes over and I apologize, but
hang on. Because I want to hold on for a minute.